It's a little known secret, but for more than half a century, a dark cloud has been looming over modern science. Here's the problem. Our understanding of the universe is based on two separate theories. One is Einstein's general theory of relativity. That's a way of understanding the biggest things in the universe. Things like stars and galaxies. But the littlest things in the universe, atoms and subatomic particles, play by an entirely different set of rules called quantum mechanics. These two sets of rules are each incredibly accurate in their own domain. But whenever we try to combine them to solve some of the deepest mysteries in the universe, disaster strikes. Take the beginning of the universe, the Big Bang. At that instant, a tiny nugget erupted violently. Over the next 14 billion years, the universe expanded and cooled into the stars, galaxies, and planets we see today. But if we run the cosmic film in reverse, everything that's now rushing apart comes back together. So the universe gets smaller, hotter, and denser as we head back to the beginning of time. As we reach the Big Bang, when the universe was both enormously heavy and incredibly tiny, our projector jams. Our two laws of physics, when combined, break down. But what if we could unite quantum mechanics and general relativity and see the cosmic film in its entirety? Well, a new set of ideas called string theory may be able to do that. And if it's right, it would be one of the biggest blockbusters in the history of science. Someday, string theory may be able to explain all of nature, from the tiniest bits of matter to the farthest reaches of the cosmos, using just one single ingredient, tiny, vibrating strands of energy called strings.
But why do we have to rewrite the laws of physics to accomplish this? Why does it matter if the two laws that we have are incompatible? Well, you can think of it like this. Imagine you lived in a city ruled not by one set of traffic laws, but by two separate sets of laws that conflicted with each other.
As you can see, it would be pretty confusing.
To understand this place, you'd need to find a way to put these two conflicting sets of laws together into one all-encompassing set that makes sense.
We work on the assumption that there is a theory out there, and it's our job, if we're sufficiently smart and sufficiently industrious, to figure out what it is.
We don't have a guarantee. It isn't written in the stars that we're going to succeed. But in the end, we hope we will have a single theory that governs everything.
But before we can find that theory, we need to take a fantastic journey to see why the two sets of laws we have conflict with each other. And the first stop on this strange trip is the realm of very large objects. To describe the universe on large scales, we use one set of laws, Einstein's general theory of relativity, and that's a theory of how gravity works. General relativity pictures space as sort of like a trampoline, a smooth fabric that heavy objects like stars and planets can warp and stretch. Now, according to the theory, these warps and curves create what we feel as gravity. That is, the gravitational pull that keeps the Earth in orbit around the Sun is really nothing more than our planet following the curves and contours that the Sun creates in the spatial fabric. But the smooth, gently curving image of space predicted by the laws of general relativity is not the whole story. To understand the universe on extremely small scales, we have to use our other set of laws, quantum mechanics. And as we'll see, quantum mechanics paints a picture of space so drastically different from general relativity that you'd think they were describing two completely separate universes. Conflict between general relativity and quantum mechanics, we need to shrink way, way, way down in size. And as we leave the world of large objects behind and approach the microscopic realm, the familiar picture of space in which everything behaves predictably begins to be replaced by a world with a structure that is far less certain. And if we keep shrinking, getting billions and billions of times smaller than even the tiniest bits of matter, atoms and the tiny particles inside of them, the laws of the very small, quantum mechanics, say that the fabric of space becomes bumpy and chaotic. Eventually, we reach a world so turbulent that it defies common sense. Down here, space and time are so twisted and distorted that the conventional ideas of left and right, up and down, even before and after, break down. There's no way to tell for certain that I'm here, or here, or both places at once. Or maybe I arrived here before I arrived here. In the quantum world, you just can't pin everything down. It's an inherently wild and frenetic place.
The laws in the quantum world are very different from the laws that we are used to. And is that surprising? Why should the world of the very small at an atomic level, why should that world obey the same kind of rules and laws that we are used to in our world with apples and oranges and walking around on the street? Why would that world behave the same way?
The fluctuating, jittery picture of space and time predicted by quantum mechanics is in direct conflict with the smooth, orderly, geometric model of space and time described by general relativity. But we think that everything, from the frantic dance of subatomic particles to the majestic swirl of galaxies, should be explained by just one grand physical principle, one master equation. If we can find that equation, how the universe really works at every time and place, will at last be revealed.
You see, what we need is a theory that can cope with the very tiny and the very massive, one that embraces both quantum mechanics and general relativity and never breaks down, ever.
Physicists, finding a theory that unites general relativity and quantum mechanics is the holy grail, because that framework would give us a single mathematical theory that describes all the forces that rule our universe. General relativity describes the most familiar of those forces, gravity. But quantum mechanics describes three other forces. The strong nuclear force, that's responsible for gluing protons and neutrons together inside of atoms. Electromagnetism, which produces light, electricity, and magnetic attraction. And the weak nuclear force, that's the force responsible for radioactive decay. Every event in the universe, from the splitting of an atom to the birth of a star, is nothing more than these four forces interacting with matter. Albert Einstein spent the last 30 years of his life searching for a way to describe the forces of nature in a single theory. And now, string theory may fulfill his dream of unification. For centuries, scientists have pictured the fundamental ingredients of nature, atoms and the smaller particles inside of them, as tiny balls or points. But string theory proclaims that at the heart of every bit of matter is a tiny, vibrating strand of energy called a string. And a new breed of scientist believes these minuscule strings are the key to uniting the world of the large and the world of the small in a single theory.
The idea that a scientific theory that we already have in our hands could answer the most basic questions is extremely seductive.
For about 2,000 years, all of our physics, essentially, has been based on, essentially, we were talking about billiard balls. The very idea of the string is such a paradigm shift. Because instead of billiard balls, you have to use little strands of spaghetti.
But not everyone is enamored of this new theory. So far, no experiment has been devised that can prove these tiny strings exist.
Now let me put it bluntly. There are physicists and there are string theorists. It is a new discipline, a new, you may call it tumor. You can call it what you will. They have focused on questions which experiment cannot address. They will deny that, these string theorists, but it's a kind of physics which is not yet testable. It does not make predictions that have anything to do with experiments that can be done in the laboratory or with observations that can be made in space or from telescopes. And I was brought up to believe, and I still believe, that physics is an experimental science. It deals with the results to experiments or, in the case of astronomy, observations.
From the start, many scientists thought string theory was simply too far out. And frankly, the strange way the theory evolved in a series of twists, turns, and accidents only made it seem more unlikely. In fact, even its birth has been turned into something of a myth, which goes like this. In the late 1960s, a young Italian physicist named Gabriele Veneziano was searching for a set of equations that would explain the strong nuclear force, the extremely powerful glue that holds the nucleus of every atom together, binding protons to neutrons. As the story goes, he happened on a dusty book on the history of mathematics, and in it, he found a 200-year-old equation, first written down by a Swiss mathematician, Leonhard Euler. Veneziano was amazed to discover that Euler's equations, long thought to be nothing more than a mathematical curiosity, seemed to describe the strong force. He quickly published a paper and was famous ever after for this accidental discovery.
I see occasionally written in books that this model was invented by chance or was found in a math book, and this makes me feel pretty bad. What is true is that the function was the outcome of a long year of work, and we accidentally discovered string theory.
However it was discovered, Euler's equation, which miraculously explained the strong force, took on a life of its own. This was the birth of string theory. Passed from colleague to colleague, Euler's equation ended up on the chalkboard in front of a young American physicist, Leonard Susskind.
To this day, I remember the formula. The formula was and I looked at it and I said, you know, this is so simple, even I can figure out what this is.
Susskind retreated to his attic to investigate. He understood that this ancient formula described the strong force mathematically. But beneath the abstract symbols, he had caught a glimpse of something new.
And I fiddled with it, I monkeyed with it, I sat in my attic, I think for 2 months on and off. But the first thing I could see in it, it was describing some kind of particles which had internal structure, which could vibrate, which could do things, which wasn't just a point particle. And I began to realize what was being described here was a string, an elastic string, like a rubber band or like a rubber band cut in half. And this rubber band could not only stretch and contract, but wiggle. And marvel of marvels, it exactly agreed with this formula. I was pretty sure at that time that I was the only one in the world who knew this.
Susskind wrote up his discovery, introducing the revolutionary idea of strings. But before his paper could be published, it had to be reviewed by a panel of experts.
I was completely convinced that when it came back, it was going to say, Susskind is the next Einstein, or maybe even the next Newton. And it came back saying, this paper is not very good, probably shouldn't be published. I was truly knocked off my chair. I was depressed, I was unhappy, I was saddened by it. It made me a nervous wreck, and the result was I went home and got drunk.
As Susskind drowned his sorrows over the rejection of his far-out idea, it appeared string theory was dead. Meanwhile, mainstream science was embracing particles as points, not strings. For decades, physicists had been exploring the behavior of microscopic particles by smashing them together at high speeds and studying those collisions. In the showers of particles produced, they were discovering that nature is far richer than they thought.
Once a month, there'd be a discovery of a new particle, the rho meson, the omega particle, the B particle. It'd be one particle, it'd be two particles, a phi, omega. More letters were used than exist in most alphabets. It was a population explosion of particles.
It was a time when graduate students would run through the halls of a physics building, say, they discovered another particle, and it fit the theories, and it was all so exciting.
And in this zoo of new particles, scientists weren't just discovering building blocks of matter. Leaving string theory in the dust, physicists made a startling and strange prediction that the forces of nature can also be explained by particles.
Now, this is a really weird idea, but it's kind of like a game of catch in which the players, like me, and me, are particles of matter.
And the ball we're throwing back and forth is a particle of force. It's called a messenger particle.
For example, in the case of magnetism, the electromagnetic force, this ball would be a photon. The more of these messenger particles or photons that are exchanged between us, the stronger the magnetic attraction.
And scientists predicted that it's this exchange of messenger particles that creates what we feel as force.
Experiments confirmed these predictions with the discovery of the messenger particles for electromagnetism, the strong force, and the weak force.
And using these newly discovered particles, scientists were closing in on Einstein's dream of unifying the forces. Particle physicists reasoned that if we rewind the cosmic film to the moments just after the Big Bang, some 14 billion years ago, when the universe was trillions of degrees hotter, the messenger particles for electromagnetism and the weak force would have been indistinguishable. Just as cubes of ice melt into water in the hot sun, experiments show that as we rewind to the extremely hot conditions of the Big Bang,
The weak and electromagnetic forces meld together and unite into a single force called the electroweak. And physicists believe that if you roll the cosmic film back even further, the electroweak would unite with the strong force in one grand superforce. Although that has yet to be proven, quantum mechanics was able to explain how three of the forces operate on the subatomic level.
And all of a sudden, we had a consistent theory of elementary particle physics, which allows us to describe all of the interactions, weak, strong, and electromagnetic, in the same language. It all made sense. And it's all in the textbooks.
Everything was converging toward a simple picture of the known particles and forces, a picture which eventually became known as the Standard Model. I think I gave it that name.
Professor Sheldon Blaschel, Abdus Salam, and Steven Weinberg.
The inventors of the Standard Model, both the name and the theory, were the toasts of the scientific community, receiving Nobel Prize after Nobel Prize. But behind the fanfare was a glaring omission. Although the Standard Model explained three of the forces that rule the world of the very small, it did not include the most familiar force, gravity. Overshadowed by the Standard Model, string theory became a backwater of physics.
Most people in our community lost completely interest in string theory. They said, okay, that was a very nice, elegant thing, but had nothing to do with nature.
It's not taken seriously by much of the community, but the early pioneers of string theory are convinced that they can smell reality and continue to pursue the idea.
But the more these diehards delved into string theory, the more problems they found.
Early string theory had a number of problems. One was that it predicted a particle which we know is unphysical. It's what's called a tachyon, a particle that travels faster than light.
There was this discovery that the theory requires 10 dimensions, which is very disturbing, of course, since it's obvious that that's more than there are.
It had the massless particle, which was not seen in experiments.
So these theories didn't seem to make sense.
This seemed crazy to people.
Basically, string theory was not getting off the ground.
People threw up their hands and said, this can't be right.
By 1973, only a few young physicists were still wrestling with the obscure equations of string theory. One was John Schwartz, who was busy tackling string theory's numerous problems. Among them, a mysterious massless particle predicted by the theory, but never seen in nature. And an assortment of anomalies or mathematical inconsistencies.
We spent a long time trying to fiddle with the theory. We tried all sorts of ways of making the dimension before, getting rid of these massless particles and the tachyons and so on. But it was always ugly and unconvincing.
For 4 years, Schwartz tried to tame the unruly equations of string theory, changing, adjusting, combining and recombining them in different ways. But nothing worked. On the verge of abandoning string theory, Schwartz had a brainstorm. Perhaps his equations were describing gravity. But that meant reconsidering the size of these tiny strands of energy.
We weren't thinking about gravity up till that point. But as soon as we suggested that maybe we should be dealing with a theory of gravity, we had to radically change our view of how big these strings were.
By supposing that strings were 100 billion times smaller than an atom, one of the theory's vices became a virtue. The mysterious particle John Schwartz had been trying to get rid of now appeared to be a graviton, the long sought-after particle believed to transmit gravity at the quantum level. String theory had produced the piece of the puzzle missing from the standard model. Schwartz submitted for publication his groundbreaking new theory describing how gravity works in the subatomic world.
It seemed very obvious to us that it was right, but there was really no reaction in the community whatsoever.
Once again, string theory fell on deaf ears. But Schwartz would not be deterred. He had glimpsed the Holy Grail. If strings described gravity at the quantum level, they must be the key to unifying the four forces. He was joined in this quest by one of the only other scientists willing to risk his career on strings, Michael Green.
In a sense, I think we had a quiet confidence that string theory is obviously correct, and it didn't matter much if people didn't see it at that point. They would see it down the line.
But for Green's confidence to pay off, he and Schwartz would have to confront the fact that in the early 1980s, string theory still had fatal flaws in the math known as anomalies. An anomaly is just what it sounds like. It's something that's strange or out of place, something that doesn't belong. Now, this kind of anomaly is just weird. But mathematical anomalies can spell doom for a theory of physics. They're a little complicated, so here's a simple example.
Let's say we have a theory in which these two equations describe one physical property of our universe. Now, if I solve this equation over here and I find x equals 1, and if I solve this equation over here and find x equals 2, I know my theory has anomalies because there should only be one value for x.
Unless I can revise my equations to get the same value for x on both sides, the theory is dead.
In the early 1980s, string theory was riddled with mathematical anomalies kind of like these, although the equations were much more complex. The future of the theory depended on ridding the equations of these fatal inconsistencies.
After Schwartz and Green battled the anomalies in string theory for 5 years, their work culminated late one night in the summer of 1984.
It was widely believed that these theories must be inconsistent because of anomalies. Well, for no really good reason, I just felt that had to be wrong, because I felt string theory's got to be right, therefore there can't be anomalies. So we decided we got to calculate these things.
Amazingly, it all boiled down to a single calculation. On one side of the blackboard, they got 496. And if they got the matching number on the other side, it would prove string theory was free of anomalies.
I do remember a particular moment when John Schwartz and I were talking at the blackboard and working out these numbers, which had to fit, and they just had to match exactly. I remember joking with John Schwartz at that moment, because there was thunder and lightning. There was a big mountain storm in Aspen at that moment. And I remember saying something like, you know, that we must be getting pretty close, because the gods are trying to prevent us completing this calculation. And indeed, they did match.
The matching numbers meant the theory was free of anomalies, and it had the mathematical depth to encompass all four forces.
So we recognized not only that the strings could describe gravity, but they could also describe the other forces. So we spoke in terms of unification, and we saw this as a possibility of realizing the dream that Einstein had expressed in his later years of unifying the different forces in some deeper framework.
We felt great. That was an extraordinary moment, because we realized that No other theory had ever succeeded in doing that.
But by now, it's like crying wolf. Each time we'd done something, I figured everyone's going to be excited. And they weren't. So I figured, by now, I didn't expect much of a reaction.
But this time, the reaction was explosive. In less than a year, the number of string theorists leapt from just a handful to hundreds.
Up to that moment, the longest talk I'd ever given on the subject was 5 minutes at some minor conference, and then suddenly I was invited all over the world to give talks and lectures and so forth.
String theory was christened the theory of everything. In early fall of 1984, I came here to Oxford University to begin my graduate studies in physics. Some weeks after, I saw a poster for a lecture by Michael Green. I didn't know who he was, but then again, I really didn't know who anybody was. But the title of the lecture was something like The Theory of Everything, so how could I resist? This elegant, new version of string theory seemed capable of describing all the building blocks of nature. Here's how. Inside every grain of sand are billions of tiny atoms. Every atom is made of smaller bits of matter, electrons orbiting a nucleus made of protons and neutrons, which are made of even smaller bits of matter called quarks. But string theory says this is not the end of the line. It makes the astounding claim that the particles making up everything in the universe are made of even smaller ingredients, tiny, wiggling strands of energy that look like strings. Each of these strings is unimaginably small. In fact, if an atom were enlarged to the size of the solar system, a string would only be as large as a tree. And here's the key idea. Just as different vibrational patterns or frequencies of a single cello string create what we hear as different musical notes, the different ways that strings vibrate give particles their unique properties, such as mass and charge. For example, the only difference between the particles making up you and me and the particles that transmit gravity and the other forces is the way these tiny strings vibrate. Composed of an enormous number of these oscillating strings, the universe can be thought of as a grand cosmic symphony. And this elegant idea resolves the conflict between our jittery, unpredictable picture of space on the subatomic scale and our smooth picture of space on the large scale. And it's the jitteriness of quantum theory versus the gentleness of Einstein's general theory of relativity that makes it so hard to bridge the two, to stitch them together. Now, what string theory does, it comes along and basically calms the jitters of quantum mechanics. It spreads them out by virtue of taking the old idea of a point particle and spreading it out into a string. So the jittery behavior is there, but it's just sufficiently less violent that quantum theory and general relativity stitch together perfectly within this framework. It's a triumph of mathematics. With nothing but these tiny, vibrating strands of energy, string theorists claim to be fulfilling Einstein's dream of uniting all forces and all matter. But this radical new theory contains a chink in its armor.
No experiment can ever check up what's going on at the distances that are being studied. No observation can relate to these tiny distances or high energies. That is to say, there ain't no experiment that could be done, nor is there any observation that could be made that would say, you guys are wrong. The theory is safe, permanently safe. Is that a theory of physics or a philosophy? I ask you.
People often criticize string theory for saying that it's very far removed from any direct experimental test, and it's surely it's not really a branch of physics for that reason. And my response to that is simply that they're going to be proved wrong.
Making string theory even harder to prove is that in order to work, the complex equations require something that sounds like it's straight out of science fiction. Extra dimensions of space.
We've always thought for centuries that there was only what we can see. You know, this dimension, that one, and another one. There's only three dimensions of space and one of time. And people who've said that there are extra dimensions of space have been labeled as, you know, crackpots or people who are bananas. Well, string theory really predicts it.
To be taken seriously, string theorists had to explain how this bizarre prediction could be true. And they claim that the far-out idea of extra dimensions may be more down to Earth than you'd think. Let me show you what I mean. I'm off to see a guy who's one of the first people to think about this strange idea.
I'm supposed to meet him at 4 o'clock at his apartment on 5th Avenue and 93rd Street on the second floor. Now, in order to get to this meeting, I need four pieces of information. One for each of the three dimensions of space, a street, an avenue, and a floor number, and one more for time, the fourth dimension. You can think about these as the four dimensions of common experience: left, right, back, forth, up, down, and time.
As it turns out, the strange idea that there are additional dimensions stretches back almost a century. Our sense that we live in a universe of three spatial dimensions really seems beyond question. But in 1919, Theodor Kaluza, a virtually unknown German mathematician, had the courage to challenge the obvious. He suggested that maybe, just maybe, our universe has one more dimension that, for some reason, we just can't see.
Look, he says here, I like your idea, so why does he delay?
You see, Kaluza had sent his idea about an additional spatial dimension to Albert Einstein. And although Einstein was initially enthusiastic, he then seemed to waver and for 2 years held up publication of Kaluza's paper. Eventually, Kaluza's paper was published after Einstein decided extra dimensions were his cup of tea. Here's the idea. In 1916, Einstein showed that gravity is nothing but warps and ripples in the four familiar dimensions of space and time. Just 3 years later, Kaluza proposed that electromagnetism might also be ripples. But for that to be true, Kaluza needed a place for those ripples to occur. So Kaluza proposed an additional hidden dimension of space. But if Kaluza was right, where is this extra dimension? And what would extra dimensions look like? Can we even begin to imagine them? Well, building upon Kaluza's work, the Swedish physicist Oscar Klein suggested an unusual answer. Take a look at the cables supporting that traffic light. From this far away, I can't see that they have any thickness. Each one looks like a line, something with only a single dimension. But suppose we could explore one of these cables way up close, like from the point of view of an ant. Now, a second dimension, which wraps around the cable, becomes visible. From its point of view, the ant can move forwards and backwards, and it can also move clockwise and counterclockwise.
So, dimensions can come in two varieties. They can be long and unfurled, like the length of the cable, but they can also be tiny and curled up, like the circular direction that wraps around it. Kaluza and Klein made the wild suggestion that the fabric of our universe might be kind of like the surface of the cable, having both big extended dimensions, the three that we know about, but also tiny curled up dimensions, curled up so tiny, billions of times smaller than even a single atom,
that we just can't see them. And so our perception that we live in a universe with three spatial dimensions may not be correct after all. We really may live in a universe with more dimensions than meet the eye. So what would these extra dimensions look like? Kaluza and Klein proposed that if we could shrink down billions of times, we'd find one extra, tiny, curled-up dimension located at every point in space. And just the way an ant can explore the circular dimension that wraps around a traffic light cable, in theory, an ant that is billions of times smaller could also explore this tiny, curled-up circular dimension. This idea that extra dimensions exist all around us lies at the heart of string theory. In fact, the mathematics of string theory demand not one, but six extra dimensions, twisted and curled into complex little shapes that might look something like this.
If string theory is right, we would have to admit that there are really more dimensions out there. And I find that completely mind-blowing.
If I take the theory as we have it now literally, I would conclude that the extra dimensions really exist. They're part of nature.
When we talk about extra dimensions, we literally mean extra dimensions of space that are the same as the dimensions of space that we see around us. And the only difference between them has to do with their shape.
How could these tiny extra dimensions, curled up into such peculiar shapes, have any effect on our everyday world? Well, according to string theory, shape is everything. Because of its shape, a French horn can produce dozens of different notes. When you press one of the keys, you change the note because you change the shape of the space inside the horn where the air resonates. And we think the curled up spatial dimensions in string theory work in a similar way. If we could shrink down small enough to fly into one of these tiny, six-dimensional shapes predicted by string theory, we would see how the extra dimensions are twisted and curled back on each other, influencing how strings, the fundamental ingredients of our universe, move and vibrate. And this could be the key to solving one of nature's most profound mysteries. You see, our universe is kind of like a finely tuned machine. Scientists have found that there are about 20 numbers, 20 fundamental constants of nature that give the universe the characteristics we see today. These are numbers like how much an electron weighs, the strength of gravity, the electromagnetic force, and the strong and weak forces. Now, as long as we set the dials on our universe machine to precisely the right values for each of these 20 numbers, the machine produces the universe we know and love. But if we change the numbers by adjusting the settings on this machine even a little bit, the consequences are dramatic. For example, if I increase the strength of the electromagnetic force, atoms repel one another more strongly, so the nuclear furnaces that make stars shine break down. The stars, including our sun, fizzle out, and the universe as we know it disappears. So, what exactly in nature sets the values of these 20 constants so precisely? Well, the answer could be the extra dimensions in string theory. That is, the tiny, curled-up, six-dimensional shapes predicted by the theory cause one string to vibrate in precisely the right way to produce what we see as a photon, and another string to vibrate in a different way, producing an electron. So, according to string theory, these minuscule, extra-dimensional shapes really may determine all the constants of nature, keeping the cosmic symphony of strings in tune. By the mid-1980s, string theory looked unstoppable. But behind the scenes, the theory was in tangles. Over the years, string theorists had been so successful that they had constructed not one, but five different versions of the theory. Each was built on strings and extra dimensions, but in detail, the five theories were not in harmony. In some versions, strings were open-ended strands. In others, they were closed loops. At first glance, a couple of versions even required 26 dimensions. All five versions appeared equally valid. But which one was describing our universe? This was kind of an embarrassment for string theorists because on the one hand, we wanted to say that this might be it, the final description of the universe. But then in the next breath, we had to say, and it comes in five flavors, five variations. Now, there's one universe, you expect there to be one theory, not five. So this is an example where more is definitely less.
One attitude that people who didn't like string theory could take was, well, you have five theories, so it's not unique.
This was a peculiar state of affairs because we were looking just to describe one theory of nature and not five.
If there's five of them, well, maybe there's smart enough people would find 20 of them, or maybe there's an infinite number of them, and you're back to just searching around at random for theories of the world.
Maybe one of these five string theories is describing our universe. On the other hand, which one and why, what are the other ones good for?
But having five string theories, even though it's big progress, raises the obvious question, if one of those theories describes our universe, then who lives in the other four worlds?
String theory seemed to be losing steam once again. And frustrated by a lack of progress, many physicists abandoned the field. Will string theory prove to be a theory of everything? Or will it unravel into a theory of nothing? Imagine that we were able to control space or control time. The kinds of things that we'd be able to do would be amazing. I might be able to go from here to here to here to here and over to here in only an instant. Now, we all think that this kind of trip would be impossible, and it probably is. But in the last few years, our ideas about the true nature of space and time have been going through some changes, and things that used to seem like science fiction are looking not so far-fetched. It's all thanks to a revolution in physics called string theory, which is offering a whole new perspective on the inner workings of the universe.
String theory holds out the promise that we can really understand questions of why the universe is the way it is at the most fundamental level.
String theory is really the Wild West of physics.
This is an area of theoretical physics which is so radically different from anything that's been before.
This radical new theory starts with a simple premise that everything in the universe, the Earth, these buildings, even forces like gravity and electricity, are made up of incredibly tiny vibrating strands of energy called strings. And small as they are, strings are changing everything we thought we knew about the universe, especially our ideas about the nature of space. To see how, let's first shrink all of space to a more manageable size. Imagine that the whole universe consisted of nothing more than my hometown, Manhattan. So now, just one borough of New York City makes up the entire fabric of space. And just for kicks, let's also imagine that I'm the CEO of a large corporation with offices on Wall Street. Because time is money, I need to find the quickest route from my apartment here in Upper Manhattan to my offices in Lower Manhattan. Now, we all know that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. But even if there's no traffic, a bit of a stretch, even in our imaginary Manhattan, it'll still take us some amount of time to get there. By going faster and faster, we can reduce the travel time. But because nothing can go faster than the speed of light, there's a definite limit to how much time we can cut from our journey. This Manhattan universe fits with an old classical vision of space, basically a flat grid that's static and unchanging. But when Albert Einstein looked at the fabric of space, he saw something completely different. He said that space wasn't static. It could warp and stretch. And there could even be unusual structures of space called wormholes. A wormhole is a bridge or a tunnel that can link distant regions of space. In effect, a cosmic shortcut. In this kind of universe, my commute would be a New Yorker's dream. But there's a hitch. To create a wormhole, you've got to rip or tear a hole in the fabric of space. But can the fabric of space really rip? Can this first step toward forming a wormhole actually happen? Well, you can't answer these questions on an empty stomach. Turns out that by looking at my breakfast, coffee and a donut, we can get a pretty good sense of what string theory says about whether the fabric of space can tear. Imagine that space is shaped like this donut. You might think that it would be very different from a region of space shaped like this coffee cup. But there's a precise sense in which the shape of the donut and the coffee cup are actually the same, just a little disguised. You see, they both have one hole. In the donut, it's in the middle, and in the coffee cup, it's in the handle. That means we can change the donut into the shape of a coffee cup and back again without having to rip or tear the dough at all. Okay, but suppose you want to change the shape of this donut into a very different shape, a shape with no holes. The only way to do that is to tear the donut like this and then reshape it. Unfortunately, according to Einstein's laws, this is impossible. They say that space can stretch and warp, but it cannot rip. Wormholes might exist somewhere fully formed, but you could not rip space to create a new one over Manhattan or anywhere else. In other words, I can't take a wormhole to work. But now, string theory is giving us a whole new perspective on space, and it's showing us that Einstein wasn't always right. To see how, let's take a much closer look at the spatial fabric. If we could shrink down to about a millionth of a billionth of our normal size, we'd enter the world of quantum mechanics. The laws that control how atoms behave. It's the world of light and electricity and everything else that operates at the smallest of scales. Here, the fabric of space is random and chaotic. Rips and tears might be commonplace. But if they were, what would stop a rip in the fabric of space from creating a cosmic catastrophe? Well, this is where the power of strings comes in. Strings calm the chaos. And as a single string dances through space, it sweeps out a tube. The tube can act like a bubble that surrounds the tear, a protective shield with profound implications. Strings actually make it possible for space to rip.
Which means that space is far more dynamic and changeable than even Albert Einstein thought. So, does that mean that wormholes are possible? Will I ever be able to take a stroll on Everest? Grab a baguette in Paris? And still make it back to New York in time for my morning meeting? It would be kind of cool, though it's still a very distant possibility. But one thing that is certain is that string theory is already showing us that the universe may be a lot stranger than any of us ever imagined.
For example, string theory says we're surrounded by hidden dimensions, mysterious places beyond the familiar three-dimensional space we know.
People who've said that there are extra dimensions of space have been labeled as, you know, crackpots or people who are bananas. I mean, what do you think there are extra dimensions? Well, string theory really predicts it.
What we think of as our universe could just be one small part of something much bigger.
Perhaps we live on a membrane, a three-dimensional membrane that floats inside a higher dimensional space.
There could be entire worlds right next to us, but completely invisible.
These other worlds would, in a very literal sense, be parallel universes. This isn't a particularly exotic or strange notion.
No wonder physics students are lining up to explore the strange world of string theory.
String theory is very active. Things are happening. There are a lot of people doing it. Most of the young kids, given the choice, at a ratio of something like 10 to 1, they will go into string theory.
But strings weren't always this popular. The pioneers of string theory struggled for years, working alone on an idea that nobody else believed in. Here's the gist of it. For decades, physicists believed that the tiniest bits inside an atom were point particles. Flying around the outside were the electrons, and inside were protons and neutrons, which were made up of quarks. But string theory says that what we thought were indivisible particles are actually tiny vibrating strings.
It is nothing really mystical. It's a really tiny string. It either closes into its little circle or it has endpoints, but it's just a little string.
In the 1980s, the idea caught on and people started jumping on the string bandwagon.
Well, the fact that suddenly all these other people were working in the field had its advantages and its disadvantages. It was wonderful to see how rapidly the subject could develop now because so many people were working on it.
One of the great attractions of strings is their versatility. Just as the strings on a cello can vibrate at different frequencies, making all the individual musical notes, In the same way, the tiny strings of string theory vibrate and dance in different patterns, creating all the fundamental particles of nature. If this view is right, then put them all together and we get the grand and beautiful symphony that is our universe. What's really exciting about this is that it offers an amazing possibility. If we could only master the rhythms of strings, then we'd stand a good chance of explaining all the matter and all the forces of nature. From the tiniest subatomic particles to the galaxies of outer space. This is the potential of string theory, to be a unified theory of everything. But at first sight, in our enthusiasm for this idea, we seem to have gone too far. Because we didn't produce just one string theory, or even two. We somehow managed to come up with five.
Five different string theories, each competing for the title of the theory of everything.
And if there's going to be the fundamental theory of nature, there ought to be one of them.
I suppose a number of string theorists thought, oh, that's fantastic, that's wonderful, and maybe one of these will end up being the right theory of the world. And yet there must have been a little nagging voice at the back of the head that said, well, why are there five?
With five competing players, the stage of string theory was looking a little crowded. The five theories had many things in common. For example, they all involved vibrating strings, but their mathematical details appeared to be quite different. Frankly, it was embarrassing. How could this unified theory of everything come in five different flavors? This was a case where more was definitely less. But then, something remarkable happened. This is Ed Witten. He's widely regarded as one of the world's greatest living physicists, perhaps even Einstein's successor.
Ed Witten is a very special person in the field. He clearly has a grasp, particularly of the underlying mathematical principles, which is far greater than most other people.
Well, you know, we all think we're very smart, and he's so much smarter than the rest of us.
In 1995, string theorists from all over the world gathered at the University of Southern California for their annual conference. Ed Witten showed up at Strings 95 and rocked their world.
I was really trying to think of something that would be significant for the occasion. And actually, since five string theories was too many, I thought I would try to get rid of some of them.
To solve the problem, Witten constructed a spectacular new way of looking at string theory.
Ed announced that he had thought about it, and moreover, he had solved it. He was going to tell us the solution to every string theory in every dimension, which was an enormous claim. But coming from Ed, it was not so surprising.
The atmosphere was electric, because all of a sudden, string theory, which had been going through kind of doldrums, was given an incredible boost, a shot in the arm.
Ed Witten gave his famous lecture, and he said a couple of words that got me interested. And for the rest of the lecture, I got hooked up on the first few words that he said and completely missed the point of his lecture.
I remember I had to give the talk after him, and I was kind of embarrassed.
Ed Witten just blew everybody away.
Ed Witten blew everybody away because he provided a completely new perspective on string theory. From this point of view, we could see that there weren't really five different theories. Like reflections in a wall of mirrors, what we thought were five theories turned out to be just five different ways of looking at the same thing. string theory was unified at last.
Witten's work sparked a breakthrough so revolutionary that it was given its own name, M theory, although no one really knows what the M stands for.
Ah, what is the M for?
M theory.
M theory.
M theory.
M theory.
M theory.
M theory is a theory.
I don't actually know what the M stands for.
Well, the M has...
I've heard many descriptions.
Mystery theory, magic theory.
It's the mother theory.
Matrix theory.
Monstrous theory. I don't know what Ed meant.
M stands for magic, mystery, or matrix, according to taste.
I suspect that the M is an upside-down W for Witten.
Some cynics have occasionally suggested that M may also stand for murky, because our level of understanding of the theory is in fact so primitive. Maybe I shouldn't have told you that one.
Whatever the name, it was a bombshell. Suddenly, everything was different.
There was a lot of panic, if you like, realizing that big things were happening and all of us not wanting to get left behind in this new revolution of string theory.
After Witten's talk, there was renewed hope that this one theory could be the theory to explain everything in the universe. But there was also a price to pay. Before M theory, strings seemed to operate in a world with 10 dimensions. These included one dimension of time, the three familiar space dimensions, as well as six extra dimensions curled up so tiny that they're completely invisible.
Well, we think these extra dimensions exist because they come out of the equations of string theory. Strings need to move in more than three dimensions. And that was a shock to everybody, but then we learned to live with it.
But M theory would go even further, demanding yet another spatial dimension, bringing the grand total to 11 dimensions.
We know that there have to be 11 dimensions for this theory to make sense. So there must be 11 dimensions. We only see 3 plus 1 of them. How is that possible?
For most of us, it's virtually impossible to picture the extra higher dimensions. I can't. And it's not surprising. Our brains evolve sensing just the three spatial dimensions of everyday experience. So, how can we get a feel for them? One way is to go to the movies. Familiar with the real world having three spatial dimensions. That is, anywhere I go, I can move left, right, back, forth, or up, down. But in the movies, things are a bit different. Even though the characters on a movie screen look three-dimensional, they actually are stuck in just two dimensions. There is no back, forth on a movie screen. That's just an optical illusion. To really move in the back-forth dimension, I'd have to step out of the screen. And sometimes, moving into a higher dimension can be a useful thing to do. So, dimensions all have to do with the independent directions in which you can move. They're sometimes called degrees of freedom. The more dimensions or degrees of freedom you have, the more you can do. That's right. And if there really are 11 dimensions, then strings can do a lot more, too.
People found fairly soon that there were objects that lived in these theories, which weren't just strings, but were larger than that. They actually looked like membranes or surfaces.
The extra dimension Witten added allows a string to stretch into something like a membrane, or a brain for short. A brain could be three-dimensional, or even more. And with enough energy, a brain could grow to an enormous size.
perhaps even as large as a universe. This was a revolution in string theory.
String theory has gotten much more baroque. I mean, now there are not only strings, there are membranes. People go on calling it a string theory, but the string theorists, I'm not sure it really is a theory of strings anymore.
The existence of giant membranes and extra dimensions would open up a startling new possibility. That our whole universe is living on a membrane inside a much larger, higher dimensional space. It's almost as if we were living inside a loaf of bread. Our universe might be like a slice of bread, just one slice in a much larger loaf that physicists sometimes call the bulk. And if these ideas are right, the bulk may have other slices, other universes, that are right next to ours, in effect, parallel universes. Not only would our universe be nothing special, but we could have a lot of neighbors. Some of them could resemble our universe. They might have matter and planets and, who knows, maybe even beings of a sort. Others could certainly be a lot stranger. They might be ruled by completely different laws of physics. Now, all of these other universes would exist within the extra dimensions of M-theory, dimensions that are all around us. Some even say they might be right next to us, less than a millimeter away. But if that's true, why can't I see them or touch them?
If you have a brain living in a higher dimensional space and your particles, your atoms, cannot get off the brain, it's like trying to reach out, but you can't touch anything. It might as well be on the other end of the universe.
And it's a very powerful idea, because if it's right, it means that our whole picture of the universe is clouded by the fact that we're trapped on just a tiny slice of the higher dimensional universe.
It is a powerful idea, especially because it may help solve one of the great mysteries of modern science. It has to do with gravity. It's been more than 300 years since Isaac Newton came up with the universal law of gravity, inspired, as the story goes, by seeing an apple fall from a tree. Today it seems obvious that gravity is a powerful force.
It would seem to most people that gravity is a very important force. It's very strong. It's very hard to get up in the morning, stand up, and when things fall, they break because gravity is strong. The fact of the matter is that it's not strong. It's really a very weak force.
Gravity pulls us down to the Earth and keeps our Earth in orbit around the Sun. But in fact, we overcome the force of gravity all the time. It's not that hard. Even with the gravity of the entire Earth pulling this apple downward, the muscles in my arm can easily overcome it. And it's not just our muscles that put gravity to shame. Magnets can do it too, no sweat. Magnets carry a different force, the electromagnetic force. That's the same force behind light and electricity.
It turns out that electromagnetism is much, much stronger than gravity. Gravity, in comparison, is amazingly weak. How weak?
The electromagnetic force is some 1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,
trying it. The weakness of gravity has confounded scientists for decades. But now, with the radical world of string theory, filled with membranes and extra dimensions, there's a whole new way to look at the problem.
One way of approaching the question of why gravity is so weak compared to all the other forces is to turn the question completely on its head and say, no, actually, gravity isn't very weak compared to all the other forces. It just appears to be weak.
It may be that gravity is actually just as strong as electromagnetism, but for some reason, we can't feel its strength.
Consider a pool table, a very large pool table. Think of the surface of the pool table as representing our three-dimensional universe, although it is just two-dimensional. And think of the billiard balls as representing atoms and other particles that the universe is made out of.
So here's the wild idea. The atoms and particles that make up stuff in the world around us will stay on our particular membrane, our slice of the universe, just as the billiard balls will stay on the surface of the pool table. Unless you're a really bad pool player. But whenever the balls collide, there is something that always seeps off the table. Sound waves. That's why I can hear the collision. Now, the idea is that gravity might be like the sound waves. It might not be confined to our membrane. It might be able to seep off our part of the universe. Or, think about it another way. Instead of pool tables, let's go back to bread. Imagine that our universe is like this slice of toast, and that you and me and all of matter, light itself, everything we see, is like jelly. Now, jelly can move freely on the surface of the toast, but otherwise it's stuck. It can't leave the surface itself. But what if gravity were different? What if gravity were more like cinnamon and sugar? Now, this stuff isn't sticky at all, so it easily slides right off the surface. But why would gravity be so different from everything else that we know of in the universe? Well, turns out that string theory, or M theory, provides an answer. It all has to do with shape. For years, we concentrated on strings that were closed loops, like rubber bands. But after M theory, we turned our attention to other kinds. Now we think that everything we see around us, like matter and light, is made of open-ended strings. And the ends of each string are tied down to our three-dimensional membrane. But closed loops of string do exist. And one kind is responsible for gravity. It's called a graviton. With closed loops, there are no loose ends to tie down, so gravitons are free to escape into the other dimensions, diluting the strength of gravity and making it seem weaker than the other forces of nature. This suggests an intriguing possibility.
If we do live on a membrane, and there are parallel universes on other membranes near us, we may never see them. But perhaps we could one day feel them through gravity.
If there happens to be intelligent life on one of the membranes, then this intelligent life might be very close to us. So theoretically, and purely theoretically, we might be able to communicate with this intelligent life by exchanging strong gravity wave sources.
So who knows? Maybe someday we'll develop the technology and use gravity waves to actually communicate with other worlds.
Are you young?
Yeah, hey, it's Brian. How you doing?
Brian. What jolly woofle of a Java Simpsons?
We don't really know if parallel universes could have a real impact on us. But there is one very controversial idea which says they've already played a major role. In fact, it gives them credit for our existence.
As the classic story goes, the vast universe we see today was once extremely small, unimaginably small. Then, suddenly, it got bigger. A lot bigger during the dramatic event known as the Big Bang. The Big Bang stretched the fabric of space and set off the chain of events that brought us to the universe we know and love today. But there's always been a couple of problems with the Big Bang theory. First, when you squeeze the entire universe into an infinitesimally small but stupendously dense package, at a certain point, our laws of physics simply break down. They just don't make sense anymore.
The formulas we use start giving answers that are nonsensical. We find total disaster. Everything breaks down, and we're stuck.
And on top of this, there's the bang itself. What exactly is that?
That's actually a problem. The classic form of the Big Bang theory really says nothing about what banged, what happened before it banged, or what caused it to bang.
Refinements to the Big Bang theory do suggest explanations for the bang, but none of them turn the clock back completely to the moment when everything started.
Most people come at this with the naive notion that there was a beginning, that somehow space and time emerged from nothingness into somethingness.
Well, I don't know about you, but I don't like nothing. Do I really believe that the universe was a big bang out of nothing? And I'm not a philosopher, so I won't say, but I can imagine to a philosopher that is a problem. But to a physicist, I think it's also a problem.
Everyone admits there are problems. The question is, can string theory solve them? Some string theorists have suggested that the Big Bang wasn't the beginning at all, that the universe could have existed long before, even forever. Not everyone is comfortable with the idea.
I actually find it rather unattractive to think about a universe without a beginning. It seems to me that a universe without a beginning is also a universe without an explanation.
So what is the explanation? What if string theory is right, and we're all living on a giant membrane inside a higher dimensional space?
One of the ideas in string theory that was particularly striking to me and suggested perhaps a new direction for cosmology is the idea of brains and the idea of brains moving in extra dimensions.
Some scientists have proposed that the answer to the Big Bang riddle lies in the movements of these giant brains.
It's so simple. Here's a brain on which we live, and here's another brain floating in the higher dimension. There's absolutely nothing difficult about imagining that these collide with each other.
According to this idea, sometime before the Big Bang, two brains carrying parallel universes began drifting toward each other. Until
all of that energy has to go somewhere. Where does it go? It goes into the Big Bang. It creates the expansion that we see, and it heats up all the particles in the universe in this big fiery mass.
As if this weren't weird enough, the proponents of this idea make another radical claim. The Big Bang was not a special event. They say that parallel universes could have collided not just once in the past, but again and again. And that it will happen in the future. If this view is right, there's a brain out there right now headed on a collision course with our universe.
So another collision is coming, and there'll be another Big Bang, and this will just repeat itself for an indefinite period into the future.
It's an intriguing idea. Unfortunately, there are a few technical problems.
Well, that was a very ingenious scenario that arose naturally within string theory. However, the good old problems creep back in again.
The fact is, we don't really know what happens when two brains collide. You can wind up with the same situation we had with the Big Bang. The equations don't make sense.
They have to make a lot of assumptions in their models, and I don't think they've really solved the problem of the Big Bang in string theory.
If string theory is the one true theory of the universe, it will have to solve the riddle of the Big Bang. And there's a lot of hope that someday string theory will succeed. But for now, there's also a lot of uncertainty. As promising and exciting as the theory is, we don't entirely understand it.
It's as if we've stumbled in the dark into a house, which we thought was a two-bedroom apartment, and now we're discovering is a 19-room mansion, at least, and maybe it's got 1,000 rooms, and we're just beginning our journey.
So how sure are we that the universe is the way that string theory describes it? Is the world really made up of strings and membranes, parallel universes, and extra dimensions? Is this all science or science fiction?
Well, the question we often ask ourselves as we work through our equations is this just fancy mathematics, or is it describing the real world?
These exercises in our imagination and mathematics are all, at the end of the day, subjected to a single question. Is it there in the laboratory? Can you find its evidence?
String theory and string theorists do have a real problem. How do you actually test string theory? If you can't test it in the way that we test normal theories, it's not science, it's philosophy. And that's a real problem.
Strings are thought to be so tiny, much smaller than an atom, that there's probably no way to see them directly. But even if we never see strings, we may someday see their fingerprints. You see, if strings were around at the beginning of the universe, when things were really tiny, they would have left impressions or traces on their surroundings. And then, after the Big Bang, when everything expanded, those traces would have been stretched out along with everything else. So if that's true, we may someday see the telltale signs of strings somewhere in the stars. But even here on Earth, there's a chance we can detect evidence of strings. This pasture in Illinois serves as command central for a lot of this research. Well, actually, the real work happens underground, where the hunt is on for evidence supporting string theory, including extra dimensions.
Not too many years ago, people who talked about large extra dimensions would have been considered crackpots, to put it lightly.
But all that has changed thanks to string theory. This is Fermilab, and right now, it's our best hope for proving that extra dimensions are real. Fermilab has a giant atom smasher. Here's how it works. Scientists zap hydrogen atoms with huge amounts of electricity. Later, they strip them of their electrons and send the protons zooming around a 4-mile circular tunnel beneath the prairie. Just as they're approaching the speed of light, they're steered into collisions with particles whizzing in the opposite direction. Most collisions are just glancing blows, but occasionally there's a direct hit. The result is a shower of unusual subatomic particles. The hope is that among these particles will be a tiny unit of gravity, the graviton. Gravitons, according to string theory, are closed loops, so they can float off into the extra dimensions. the grand prize would be a snapshot of a graviton at the moment of escape.
And then the graviton goes to the extra dimension, and then it shows in the detector by its absence. You see it by its absence.
Unfortunately, Fermilab hasn't yet seen the vanishing graviton. And the pressure is on, because another team is hot on the same trail. ...4,000 miles away, on the border of France and Switzerland, a lab called CERN is constructing an enormous new atom smasher. When it's finished, it will be 7 times more powerful than Fermilab's.
There's a great sense of urgency that every minute has to count. But eventually, CERN, our rival laboratory, will, frankly, blow us out of the water.
CERN will blow Fermilab out of the water, not only in the search for extra dimensions, but other wild ideas.
At the top of the to-do list for both labs is the hunt for something called supersymmetry. That's a central prediction of string theory, and it says in a nutshell that for every subatomic particle we're familiar with, like electrons, photons, and gravitons, there should also be a much heavier partner called a sparticle, which so far no one has ever seen. Now, because string theory says sparticles should exist, finding them is a major priority.
So it's a big discovery to find supersymmetry. That's a humongous discovery, and I think it's a bigger discovery to find supersymmetry than to find life on Mars.
If we were to hear tomorrow that supersymmetry was discovered, there would be parties all over the planet.
The problem is, if they exist, the sparticles of supersymmetry are probably incredibly heavy. So heavy that they may not be detected with today's atom smashers.
The new facility at CERN will have the best chance once it's up and running in several years. But that won't stop the folks at Fermilab from trying to find them first.
The competition is friendly and fierce at the same time. We're competing like bad dogs, essentially. And it has always been like that, and it will always be like that.
We have to make sure that we don't make any mistakes, that we do absolutely the best we can do with these experiments, and take advantage of what is really one of the great golden opportunities for discovery.
If we do find sparticles, it won't prove string theory, but it will be really strong circumstantial evidence that we're on the right track. Over the next 10 to 20 years, the new generation of atom smashers is sure to uncover surprising truths about the nature of our universe. But will it be the universe predicted by string theory? What if we don't find sparticles or extra dimensions?
What if we never find any evidence that supports this weird new universe filled with membranes and tiny vibrating strings? Could string theory, in the end, be wrong?
Oh yes, it's certainly a logical possibility that we've all been wasting our time for the last 20 years, and the theory is completely wrong.
There have been periods of many years where all of the smart people, all of the cool people, were working on one kind of theory, moving in one kind of direction, and even though they thought it was wonderful, it turned out to be a dead end. This could happen to string theory.
Even though there's no real evidence yet, so much of string theory just makes so much sense. A lot of us believe it's just got to be right.
I don't think it's ever happened that a theory that has the kind of mathematical appeal that string theory has turned out to be entirely wrong. I would find it hard to believe that that much elegance and mathematical beauty would simply be wasted.
I don't really know how close we are to the end. You know, are we almost there and having the complete story? Is it going to still be another 10 years? Nobody knows. But I think it's going to keep me busy for a long time.
We have been incredibly lucky. Nature has somehow allowed us to unlock the keys to many fundamental mysteries already. How far can we push that? We won't know until we try.
A century ago, some scientists thought they had pretty much figured out the basic laws of the universe. But then Einstein came along and dramatically revised our views of space and time and gravity. And quantum mechanics unveiled the inner workings of atoms and molecules, revealing a world that's bizarre and uncertain. So, far from confirming that we had sorted it all out, the 20th century showed that every time we looked more closely at the universe, we discovered yet another unexpected layer of reality. As we embark on the 21st century, we're getting a glimpse of what may be the next layer. Vibrating strings, sparticles, parallel universes, and extra dimensions. It's a breathtaking vision. And in a few years, experiments may begin to tell us whether some of these ideas are right or wrong.
But regardless of the outcome, we'll keep going because, well, that's what we do. We follow our curiosity. We explore the unknown. And 100 or 1,000 years from now, today's view of the cosmos may look woefully incomplete, perhaps even quaint. But undeniably, the ideas we call string theory are a testament to the power of human creativity. They've opened a whole new spectrum of possible answers to age-old questions. And with them, we've taken a dramatic leap in our quest to fully understand this elegant universe.